Hey, good news. Today we're joined by Victoria, who's going to help us get right into the nitty-gritty of the tools necessary to get going in DevSecOps. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show, where we'll be discussing the challenges you and our other tech-savvy customers have encountered. Together, we're going to be talking with experts to find out how they think about these problems, recommended tools and best practices, and tips they've learned from years of experience that you can use. So today, we're very lucky to have Victoria Almazova, a senior security architect. And today, we're going to talk a little bit about getting really deep into some of the tools that are involved in this. So in order to do that, I'm going to go back to customer mode, and I'm going to become a customer again. Excellent. So Victoria, thanks for being willing to talk with me again. Last time we were talking about DevSecOps, and this time you agreed to help me sort of get into the intricacies, the nut and bolts of it. But just to make sure I understand, can we just go over that DevSecOps thing one more time, just so I get what we're doing in the first place?
Yeah, let's do so. Let me show my slide, please. Okay, so last time we spoke a lot about implementing security in the DevOps or DevSecOps, which may contain a lot of the things, like starting from the threat modeling and ending with the continuous monitoring when we are in the production. So, and we agreed that we need to start somewhere, right? So. Right. As we are quite close in the development, let's start with the CI/CD pipeline in this particular case, and let's focus there. And specifically, let's focus on the few things. For example, dependency management and the security scanning. Does it make sense?
Yeah, it makes perfect sense. Why would you want to just do this small part here?
I tend to say, like, you need to follow the Pareto principle, like 80-20. Focus on the 20% of your tasks, which will cover 80% of your needs. In this particular case, according to the statistics, for example, in the development, we use more than 75% of third-party libraries, and they may contain a lot of the vulnerabilities. So if we look into that part, we're gonna cover a lot of the WOS vulnerabilities. And then if we will do, for example, the security scanning of your application, we may cover the OWASP top 10 or the open web application security project top 10 listed most common security vulnerabilities. So if we will take only these two practices, we will cover kind of a lot of the potential security threats.
Okay, I'm all for it then. Just to make this a little less abstract, is there any way you could actually see how this is really done?
Yeah, let me try to show you. Like here we're looking on the development from the linear perspective, but let's look from the developer side. So when you do the development, you push, like you write your code in your favorite IDE, or intelligent development environment, like Visual Studio Code. And then you do your development in your branch. It depends on your branch strategies. Once you feel that the code is pushed and is ready, you compile it. And in this particular case, I want as well to focus on the dockerization, because in today's world, we do a lot of the Docker containers, and we push the images as well. We compile the images. So in this particular scenario, we look into the, we push the image into the Docker registry. And then we go to our dev stage. And once we play around as a developer, we feel that we wrote our functionality, or that we covered the user story. And we feel that it can go to the main branch. We just push our development branch to the main, and the process repeats itself, right? Only with the difference that it goes to the QA stage. And once the testing is done and everyone is happy, we go to the production. So in this particular case, I want to focus today on the two things. On our source code, where we have our libraries, and on our environments. Like in this particular case, I want to look into the application which we have developed and on the Docker.
Super. Okay, so PowerPoint is awesome, but I would be even more interested to see how it's sort of done in real life. Do you have any way of showing me that?
I fully agree with you. Let's go to the Azure DevOps. So, David, I have created for you the example pipeline in Azure DevOps, but you can achieve pretty similar concept as well in GitHub. In this particular case, we do have the Java application, which we compile, and when we build it and push it to the container registry, all other tasks or the steps what I have added on the top are focused purely on the security. Like I mentioned, where there are the some areas which I want to focus, and one of them is obviously we want to look into the our source code and try to find if there are some hard-coded usernames and the passwords, because that's not a good practice, correct?
Right.
And then I did the example for you, like when we look into our packages or the third-party libraries, we can do it with the different tools, with the commercial or the open source. So in this particular case, I do have the white source bolt, which looks into our third-party applications for the security vulnerabilities and for the licensing, and as well the open source solution, which coming from the same OWASP organization, which doesn't do only the writing the guidelines of top 10, but as well the community writes some security tools, which allows you to detect who's a threat like during your development. Like in this particular case, this is a dependency check. And I'm publishing the dependency check results in the test. So once the code is compiled, I want to be sure that my application at least doesn't have the OWASP top 10 security vulnerabilities. And that's why I'm running against my application ZAP Scanner, which does the scanning in this case, like against these security vulnerabilities. Does it make sense so far?
Yeah, it makes total sense. So the reason why the ZAP thing is coming later is, so I'm a little just confused about that, because the other, it looks like you were scanning before you built it. Why is ZAP after you build it?
That's a good question. So in the security world, you can look into your application in the two ways. One is what is called the static security analysis, and another is the dynamic security analysis. In this case, I wanted to show you the latter, like the dynamic security analysis. And for that, the tool or the scanner needs to have already compiled and running application. So what it does, it just takes your compiled application and spin it up as in the container together with that security scanning tool and scans it.
Okay, so I understand, but and it looked like there was another stage of the pipeline I saw lower there. Once all the scanning is done?
Yeah, once is the scanning done, I want to have these results somewhere. And what I'm doing, like I'm publishing them as a test result, and we will look into that just in a few seconds. Okay, and the last step as well, I want to focus on my Docker image, because you shouldn't assume that if you put your application in the Docker image that is already like in the secure environment, because when you configure your image, you may contain some security threats as well in the image itself. So it's quite important to look into that that part as also. So for that task, I have chosen the Anchor, but there are plenty other security tools available on the marketplace. So you can pick, play around and choose what fits perfectly for you. Good. So how does it look with the pipeline for you? Everything is clear?
Yeah, it makes total sense. Now I have to admit, I'm curious, like what does it look, what if it finds anything, what does it look like? Like, how do I know?
Yeah, that's a good point. So once you run the pipeline, the first thing what we can focus is our credential scanner, because we want to start from there. And in this particular case, I'm having the result in the logs. And you see, it seems we do have the sum credentials in our code, hard-coded, and which is not good. We need to fix it. As you can see, I'm placing this in the log, and I'm not breaking the pipeline, because it is quite important when you introduce the new security tool not to cause additional friction, because the developers need to have a time to learn and understand how the tool works. And that's why I'm not breaking the build pipeline here. Of course, later when you get more comfortable with the tool, you would add the task that once the vulnerability has been found, please break the build pipeline. Does it make sense?
Yeah, and by break, you mean the pipeline stops at this point and doesn't continue on to build and put into or to deploy or whatever. It just stops right here. That's what you mean. You don't mean the pipeline itself stops functioning. You mean it just it ceases right at the moment where it discovers a vulnerability.
Correct. The build fails. It will not be successful. So then it's pretty similar if you find this when you do the code quality checks, right? For example, with the SonarQube or other tools. And if it doesn't satisfy, you just break the build.
I understand. Okay. And so that's the cred scan results. Are there other results that we get out of this?
Yes. So the next area where we want to focus is all about these third-party libraries. And this output is from the white source vault, which actually creates the separate tab under the Azure DevOps, where it represents all the findings, what it found in your application, like the source code, like what type of the libraries have been involved. And as you can see, luckily, we don't have the high high risk findings, but we do have the medium. And if you look into the details, we can see not only which library contains them, but as well what type of the security issue is there, and as well the some top fix instruction. That makes for life for the developers easier, because then they understand what they need to do. Like I mentioned, for your particular case, I wanted to create another example of representing these findings. And in this case, let me maybe bit zoom out so to show you the full picture. So in this case, what I did, I have implemented, or I'm publishing, the dependency scanning results as a part of your test results. And as well, I do this with the application scanning, with the dynamic application scanner, which we did with OWASP scanner. And as you can see, we do have the findings. And it may sound like the rate is pretty decent, but still we have the findings here as a test result. And you may choose which way you want to implement these security tools. Maybe this way is better, because you tend to check all the test results and you already are familiar with this part. So we have looked on our application and we found some of the OWASP top 10 practices are not followed, so we need to fix them. And that's just as an example or another way to showing the same third-party libraries findings. Yes, and I guess we have left the last one, the container scanning. And in this case, what we have, I have configured in the way that the container scanning result may end up being as an additional artifact with the separate reporting document. Why it's needed? Because sometimes the security teams want to have this type of the report at their own place, and they want to take them for the after usage and helping you maybe to improve and so on. So we have published our anchor results, and the example of them looks following. And as you can see, even in our example, we did not do a lot of the configuration of our image. We just took the default one, which is available from the repositories, and we found out that there are a lot of the libraries or the the system libraries were not up to date. That means we need as well to focus on our images containers. So this is a quite short example which I wanted to share with you to show how you can implement some of the security tools with the same developer experience.
So that's super useful. It's nice to see it like really practical and exactly the way I'd expect to see it, since I'm in ADO all the time, in Azure DevOps all the time. So I think with that sort of stuff, that gets me where I needed to go to get started. It gives me a sense of what it's going to look like. So I think with that, what I'm going to do is switch back to host mode. Okay, back to host mode. So I just want to thank you, Victoria, and I want to thank all of you who are watching this for watching this episode of the Azure Enablement Show. Please don't forget to like, comment, share, and subscribe, and join us again for more of the Azure Enablement Show.